Hey guys, welcome back to another COVID-19 video. So in my last one, I said I would be following President Trump's COVID-19 health status very closely. And the truth is, from a medical standpoint, he's doing just fine and will most likely be just fine. I say this because most patients who have improvement in symptoms continue to do so. And he looked well when he walked up the stairs of the White House and when he did that photo op. But there's this potential for his clinical course to go south, especially around that day 7 to 10 mark. So his doctors are still gonna continue to monitor him very closely. Now, a lot of people are talking about dexamethasone, which is a steroid medication, specifically a glucocorticoid. Yes, it can cause anxiety, irritation, psychosis, delirium, sleep disturbance. This is why when we do give steroids, we try to avoid giving them before sleep or avoid giving them at nighttime. When a physician or clinician is assessing someone's mental status or psychiatric state, it's important to know what they are normally like at their baseline. Are they acting differently? That's really what you're looking for. So, steroids are prescribed very frequently, and these side effects are not necessarily rare. It's not like we give steroids and necessarily expect them to have these side effects. It's very hard to put a number on how often these side effects occur. Mainly because there's just so many different medications that people take at the same time. And there's also other factors that can cause these symptoms. So there's lots of different reasons for people to have changes in mental status. So you'll never get a concrete number on how often these mental side effects occur. But if I had to put a number based on my experience, I'd say probably less than 10% of all the people that I prescribe steroids for, whether that be for asthma exacerbations, COPD exacerbations, or other reasons for people to be on steroids, including severe ARDS. And that's even before COVID. But besides steroids, can COVID-19 itself cause changes in brain function? And the answer is yes. Can there be long-term effects of the brain? The answer is yes. And that brings me to the title of this video, the long-term effects of COVID-19, the so-called long haulers. Well, let me start out by saying there are over 30 million documented COVID-19 cases in the world, with over 1 million deaths in the world and over 200,000 deaths in the United States. So we hear in the media, everyone's talking about the number of cases and the number of deaths, but not a lot of people are talking about the long-term side effects, the long haulers. The clinical spectrum of disease can range anywhere from no symptoms to mild symptoms to pneumonia to ARDS and shock with multi-organ failure and sometimes death. Because COVID-19 is a new disease, the possible long-term health consequences are still not well known. So these long-term effects of COVID-19, we can call this the post-acute COVID-19. So this is defined as the presence of symptoms that extend beyond 3 weeks from the initial onset of symptoms. And chronic COVID-19 is when it extends beyond 12 weeks. So back in 2016, of course, before COVID, there was a study in patients who recovered from various illnesses where these patients required ICU level of care, and many of them required a ventilator. 84% of the patients in this study, they reported impairment in cognitive, mental health, or physical function that persisted for 6 to 12 months beyond hospital discharge. And this is collectively known as post-intensive care syndrome. There was recently a study in Italy that assessed COVID-19 system persistence among 143 patients that were discharged from the hospital. And only 18 of these patients were completely free of any COVID-19 related symptoms after an average of 60 days after their initial symptom onset. But post-acute COVID-19 syndrome is not just seen in those who've had severe illness and were hospitalized. In a telephone survey conducted by the CDC among a random sample of over 290 adults who had a positive outpatient COVID-19 test and were symptomatic, about one-third said they did not return to their usual state of health 2 weeks or more after testing. And this occurred in all ages of adults, although it did occur more frequently in the older age groups. The most commonly reported symptoms after acute COVID-19 are fatigue and shortness of breath. And this is exactly what I've been seeing with some of my patients with COVID-19. This is persistence of fatigue and this feeling of shortness of breath that still lingers on. Other symptoms include joint pain and chest pain. In addition to these symptoms, there are cases of patients with specific organ dysfunction, primarily involving the heart, lungs, brain, and sometimes even kidneys. This might be a result of viral invasion by hijacking those ACE2 receptors in our body, but it can also be related to the intense inflammation and cytokine storm, or a combination of these. But let's start with the organ that's most impacted by this virus, of course, the lungs. Now, in a study of 55 patients with COVID-19, at 3 months after discharge, 35 had persistent symptoms, and 39 had abnormal findings on chest x-ray or CAT scan, meaning they had interstitial thickening and evidence of fibrosis or scarring. I have many patients with this post-COVID-19 lung scarring. In two different studies that were done, they looked at patients with COVID-19 who were discharged from the hospital. At about 3 months after discharge, about 25 to 30% of these patients had at least some impairment in lung function, as evidenced by the pulmonary function tests. And this is frustrating for me when I see my patients with this because I have nothing I can give them to improve their lung function. I can't imagine how frustrated that they feel. Okay, so what about the heart? Now, heart damage, aka myocardial injury, as defined by an increased troponin level in the blood, has been described in patients with severe acute COVID-19. Inflammation of the heart muscle, meaning myocarditis, in addition to heart arrhythmias, have also been described after SARS-CoV-2 infection. I actually dedicated an entire video to this topic, so you can check that out for more details. And so what about the brain? The virus that causes COVID-19, SARS-CoV-2, can infiltrate brain tissue when the virus gets in the blood. It can also get to the brain by invading the olfactory nerve, which is the nerve here responsible for smell. This is why loss of smell is actually a common symptom of COVID-19. Besides loss of smell and loss of taste, the most common long-term neurologic symptoms after COVID-19 are headache and dizziness. Less common, but still possible, is stroke, brain inflammation, meaning encephalitis, and seizures. But check this out. So previous pandemics with SARS, MERS, and influenza, they've had people where they've recovered from those illnesses, and then they had neuropsychiatric issues that actually lingered on for months. So we're talking about cognitive health here, like depression, anxiety, and post-COVID-19 is known to cause brain fog and mood swings. This has been reported up to 2 to 3 months after the initial COVID illness. And you can imagine what the emotional impact of having to endure a long course of COVID would be like. Individuals recovering from COVID-19 may be at even greater risk of depression, anxiety, post-traumatic stress disorder, and substance use disorder. This just compounds on the current global health crisis. But it's not just the people who've had COVID-19 that it can take a stress on their mental health. So everyone's mental health, having to physically distance, how that makes people feel more lonely or isolated, this can create a sense of hopelessness. A diagnosis of COVID-19 and the subsequent need for physical distancing has been associated with feelings of isolation and loneliness. Now, as time passes, more studies will be done and we'll learn more about COVID-19 and all the aspects of it with regard to mental health and all the organ-specific health as well. In the meantime, the only real tool that we have are masks, and hopefully soon we get a safe and effective vaccine, and hopefully soon we get some therapies that really work. And there are lots of them being studied. Some are looking more promising than others, including the one that President Trump got, the REGN-CoV-2, which is made out of two monoclonal antibodies. But I'm going to end on that note. So if you made it this far, thanks for watching. And leave a comment below. Let me know your thoughts. And I'll try to get to all the comments. It's easier said than done because sometimes there's just so many. But anyway, if you haven't already, make sure you subscribe. Hit that bell notification so you get notified of when my next one comes out. And in the meantime, stay safe and stay healthy.